Now I know what you're thinking. I did not wear the same clothes as every day. I just made the video right after the last one. So don't think that. Today we're going to be talking about how does our government achieve their national economic goals. Now, the first part of this lesson we already discussed at the beginning of the chapter. We said that government policymakers have three main national economic goals for their economy. And to remind ourselves what those three were, number one was that we want economic growth. We want our economy to continue making more stuff over time. And we assess that by using GDP. Number two, we want full employment, where all eligible people who want to work can find employment at a current wage rate. And we measure that by looking at our unemployment rate in the country. And our third thing is we want to keep prices stable, which means we don't want inflation and we don't want deflation. And we use that by looking at inflation, which we are going to talk about in great detail next chapter. So those are the three main national economic goals. So how does our government accomplish that? Well, one tool of government policymaking is using fiscal policy. Fiscal policy is designed to influence spending habits in consumers. So fiscal policy means we're going to try and make consumers spend money in different ways. And ways that we can do that is changing the level of taxes. So our government can change taxes to influence spending. We can also change the amount that our government spends. This is very topical right now during the pandemic because as of, when are you going to be watching this video? As of Tuesday, yes, as of Tuesday of last week, the government approved a $2 trillion stimulus package, which altered the level of our government spending to influence fiscal policy. So this is going on right now. If the government lowers the taxes, well, that means you have more money to spend. So that's fiscal policy, designing the way that you spend your money. If we lower taxes, it means you have more money to spend. And if we increase taxes, the government can have more money to start projects and support social programs. So either way the government decides to go, you're going to have an influence on fiscal spending. So this is the Republican side. Republicans like to lower taxes. You choose how you spend your money. Democrats are more so, let's raise taxes and let's start projects. Let's support social programs. And through that, we'll be able to hire people and we'll be able to support people, especially those of lower incomes. Both sides work. It's just a different ideology. Now, I showed this picture on the very first page. Anyone know what this is of? Yes, Timmy. Yeah, you're right. It is the Federal Reserve Building in Washington, D.C. So another tool that the government policymakers have is something different than taxes and government spending, because that's kind of like Congress and the president. This deals with the Fed, and we're going to have a whole chapter on that after inflation. So this is called monetary policy, which is designed at regulating the money supply and our interest rates in the country. And monetary policy is not carried out by Trump and Congress. It's carried out by the Fed. And the leader of the Fed is this guy, Jerome Powell. The Fed has 12 different banks spread throughout the United States. Our closest one is up here in San Francisco. It's also chartered by a central bank in Washington, D.C. And there are a few ways that the Fed can design its monetary policies. One way is altering the amount of money that's out there, amount of money that's circulating in the economy. So they can increase or lower the amount of actual cash out there. An additional way is that the Fed can set monetary policies by adjusting an interest rate, a very key interest rate that we're going to go into in a couple chapters. And that interest rate pretty much decides, like, is it easy or difficult to borrow money? If it's easier to borrow money, well, you're going to have more spending. A third way that the Fed can set monetary policies is by changing deposit requirements for banks. So they can say to a bank, hey, you, Bank Chase or Wells Fargo or Bank of America, you have to keep X percent of amount of your money in your vaults and you can't hand that out to customers through loans. So if they increase that rate, it now makes it harder to borrow and it decreases the amount of money that's spent in your economy. So these three activities that the Fed can all take, all affect the amount of money circulating in the economy. Whereas before it was like, okay, how are we going to try and spend money? Monetary policies, how much money is there out there? When more money circulates in an economy, that means that there's more economic activity. It's easier to get money, goods and services are purchased more frequently, and more economic activity happens. So you're probably thinking, well, why on earth wouldn't you want that? Why wouldn't you want people spending your money? Why would you want to decrease money supply? Well, the reason is because of inflation, or we're worried about the economy overheating, meaning the economy can be growing too quickly. And when the economy grows too quickly, then you're going to have inflation. And inflation's not good. So yes, you want people to spend money, but to a certain extent. So if an economy overheats and the Fed wants you to encourage saving to get rid of the inflation effects, it can actually decrease the amount of money in circulation to lower the demand of goods or services. Right now, in the United States, we're doing the exact opposite of this, right? Because we want people to spend money, because right now people aren't spending money. We're not going out to eat, we're not taking vacations, right? Think of all the things that you would normally do that you're not doing right now. Basically, any form of entertainment's out the window. You're just staying at home, watching Netflix, and eating stuff from the grocery store. The government makes spending decisions that are factored into our budget, right? We can't just make these decisions like the $2 trillion in stimulus that we provided last week on Tuesday. We can't just do that with a wave of a wand. So when the government spends more money than it collects in a given year, which happens quite frequently, by the way, our government has a budget deficit for that year. So for example, in 2020, it was projected, this is totally gonna change, because we spent $2 trillion in one day, but it was projected that we would bring in about $3.64 trillion, and we spend about $4.75 trillion, leaving ourselves with that deficit of the difference of $1 trillion. It's going to be more because of what they just passed, though. Budget deficits then add to the debt. The debt is the total amount from year to year to year to year, how much money we're in the toilet, how much money are we in the hole that we owe. So currently, the national debt of the United States is over $22 trillion. So the difference between deficit and debt, deficits for one year, it's how much money you lost in one given year, debt is over all the years. And if you want to take a look at this, we'll take a look at the end. USdebtclock.org kind of gives you a graphic there. I'll pull it up right after. This is our last slide. When an economy is low growth or contraction, a recession occurs. Like what, unfortunately, what's probably going to happen right now. We haven't had a recession since 2008. Unfortunately, we're probably going to have another recession. But when your economy is doing well, like between 2011 and 2019, you have an economic boom. And that's when your economy is having a lot of growth. So a couple other terms for you, a recession and a boom. Let's take a look at that debt clock and then we'll end the video. So the debt clock again shows just how much debt there is in the United States. You can take a look at it on your own because you probably can't see these numbers. But it shows you all the different ways that our government is losing money. And we're losing money in a lot of different ways. So take a look at that on your own time, usdebtclock.org. And that's the end of today about money. Actually, that's the end of the chapter. So you're going to do this assignment and stay tuned and look out for an assessment regarding how I want you to assess all this information on how well the economy is doing in our economic indicators. Have a good one. Let's go out to the money song again. That's it for Money at Chapter 14. See you later.